commissions, right? You have your board, you have your professional side, you have your functional areas. That's really nice on paper. But the reality looks much more like this. Okay? So you have your vision of Railroad City, and you put some thoughts onto it, but then you have to clarify that vision. You have to make it clear to yourselves, to other people, to all the stakeholders. They have to buy into that vision. But the vision alone isn't enough. As Jurgen pointed out very clearly, you need to identify this sweet spot. You have to figure out what's your competitive advantage. What are your assets and obstacles? What are the critical success factors you have to address? And then you turn the vision and sweet spot into a development strategy. And what was missing in the Thai, as you identified, and was missing in the Thai example is, they didn't properly identify one of the critical success factors, which was the transfer of land ownership. And if they didn't do that right, then the development strategy they had, it's just not going to work. So it's not, and also you don't only can assess your assets, you have to identify your obstacles. So what are the critical success factors? If you can, as you talked about in your urban renewal program, if you can leverage people's desire to improve their housing as a way of getting them to buy into this project, then you're taking a problem and leveraging it into an asset. If you haven't taken into consideration, then you're stuck with a problem, you know, and it's on your critical path of success that you haven't been able to move ahead. So, in this, I think Ruth, right, you're the one who asked about what are the, you know, what are the, how do you hold this together? You have to think about it as you're on your journey, okay? And after you come and you've gone through this piece here, you need your development strategy. And then you have to say, well, wait a minute, how am I going to finance this? And so the financing process goes back in and affects your development strategy. And the design says, well, how much money am I going to need? And then you have a loop here that you have to go around a couple of times. But then you're going to go on the road, and from your design, you're going to have to go into your governance structure. And so the governance structures we talked about earlier are all of those different components that pull it all, begin to pull it all together. And if you're at this point now, it's when you move to here that you have to find your legal anchors. Because if you go from design to governance structure and it's not in the legal authority, then you have a serious problem. If you're not aware of financing it, it's not going to be happening. And from your governance structure, then out of this, you can begin to design your specific ventures. And the ventures require your risk analysis and your more detailed business plan. So here you've looked at, you've done your back of the envelope things and a little bit more back of the envelope here, and you've begun to design a few things. And here you need to say, okay, how are we going to do the specific ventures? How are they going to be designed? Is it PPP? Is it BOT? Is it straightforward private development? Is it something the KRC is going to be the manager of? Is it a public service that the municipality and the county are going to provide? And they're different. They're not the same. And some of them are joint ventures and some of them are separate. And then what infrastructure is needed here to keep it? Where are the, how are you going to maintain it? Not only how are you going to finance it, but how are you going to logistically maintain it? And then as it happens, then comes the long, long road of adaptation. Because it's never straightforward. And you see, it doesn't go in a nice, straight, even nice line like these. It's a windy road, and it goes back and forth, and you have loops in it, and it goes back. And then finally, you begin to happen. It's not done just because it's beginning to happen, because you have to have an adaptation, and then from there, more innovation. So this is the type of spiral process that you're engaged in. And the question is, how do you maintain that? What are the institutional characteristics? And my advice and my experience has led me to say that, as I mentioned in the first thing, the two principles. One is the KISS principle again. There's less management structure, the least complicated that is, the more you will be able to have the capacity to act together. Secondly, figure out a way in which you're talking about cooperation, concerted effort, not co-paralysis. KRC has to be able to act independent of the county. The county has to be able to act independent of KRC. The developer has to be able to act independently of the other two. But they all have to work together for shared vision. So your development structure may, in fact, you may decide to set up a joint development corporation. That may be the way to go forward in doing that. In many places, in particular, I know in downtown Jerusalem, we have the Jerusalem Municipal and Public Development Authority. They're responsible for the integration of everything, from the light rail to the storefronts, to the planning, and so on. But they're not the ones that do it. They're not the developers. They may be, they have a separate company that does infrastructure development because the city isn't geared to move quickly enough to do that. In other places, they hire out and they do subcontracting for certain pieces of it. So these are the ways in which you have to put it all together. So let me go from this to one other short presentation. But this is really the heart of it.